The bridge, not long or wide, is a simple wooden structure that spans the narrow yet profound gap between past disappointments and future uncertainties. Let me introduce myself. I'm Lyle Jetterman, now 38, a man who previously only differed from others in that he was the husband of 36-year-old Gloria and the father of 12-year-old Robert and 8-year-old Anna. It's a pleasant family picture, albeit with a significant financial burden. To meet my duties as a husband and father, I worked at Countryman Realtor for 5 years before Gabriel Zelo bought the company from Bernie Schleifer. Real estate wasn't my first career choice, or even my desired one. I started my career after graduating from law school. At that time, I had been married to Gloria for 3 years, and she was pregnant when I graduated. The job market for young lawyers wasn't very promising, but Gloria's pregnancy gave me a strong incentive to find a job that could support my family. The initial job I secured was at a law firm specializing in representing banks during home loan closings. It wasn't the career I had envisioned, but it was employment. While I pursued my law degree, Gloria worked as a bank teller to support us both. Her earnings covered rent and necessities, while I worked part-time jobs to supplement our income. My education was funded through loans and scholarships, but I aimed for a future with the Department of Education. Since Gloria became pregnant around my law school graduation, I accepted the job offer, marking the first of many compromises in married life. In those bygone days, banks extended loans to individual homebuyers for house purchases, a profession considered genteel for lawyers. I sat at the desk handling house flipping transactions on behalf of lending institutions. During mortgage closings, buyers paid the bank a commission of roughly $500 for my services. The law firm received this sum along with an additional $500 from the insurance company. Each successful closing meant earning a solid $1,000 when we sealed the deal. Naturally, the firm profited, and I received a small portion as my salary. It seems all good things must end, and honorable frugality gives way to insatiable greed. Shortly after my wife Gloria gave birth to our second child, the consolidation of small banks into larger ones, which were then absorbed by even bigger ones, reshaped the banking landscape. Retail loans became obsolete as banking transitioned into a wholesale trade, operating at an industrial scale. Each morning, I'd confront a stack of mortgage paperwork at work, slated for same-day closings. While profits likely soared, the frenetic pace of simultaneous house closings left me with an uneasy feeling about the sustainability of this model. Over my 7-year legal career, I didn't advance to partnership, but ascended to the esteemed status of a private contractor, earning $75 per closing. With 7 or 8 loans closed daily, 5, and sometimes 6 days a week, my income was respectable. However, I harbored doubts about the longevity of this arrangement, sensing an impending downturn. Bernard Schleifer, or Bernie as he preferred, approached me. Seeking a legally savvy individual, Bernie aimed to expand his company, Countryman Real Estate. With his main contract transitioning to the Sun Belt, Bernie eyed growth. His company held shares in the Scarlet Woods development, boasting 100 approved lots with plans for 400 more. Strategically located 2 miles from a tech park with 2,000 high-tech jobs on the horizon, Bernie, a builder developer, excelled at securing financing for growth projects. However, he struggled to market to homeowners seeking upgrades or adjustable rate mortgages. Strangely enough, when Bernie and I first met, everything clicked. I thrived on selling houses and paid close attention to details, especially when it came to managing the flurry of paperwork involved in transactions. Drawing from lessons learned from previous employers, I implemented profit center strategies, boosting Bernie's sales by leveraging partnerships with home insurance agents, movers, gardeners, and more. We swiftly evolved into a comprehensive agency with one goal: maximizing home sales and capitalizing on associated services. Bernie wasted no time in initiating construction projects, while I diligently managed day-to-day operations. He handled major deals, while I took care of smaller ones, earning a handsome salary as his trusted employee. Bernie foresaw the impending crisis. Bear Stearns served as a precursor, but the collapse of investment bank Lehman Brothers was the catalyst. Despite the looming catastrophe, Bernie remained optimistic, believing in real estate's inherent resilience. While the market plummeted, Bernie remained unfazed, confident in its eventual rebound. I focused on maximizing every opportunity, channeling profits into larger and more lucrative rural properties as part of Bernie's investment strategy. Bernie had only one concern. He felt like a significant figure in a small arena and desired to dive into the vast ocean. One evening, during drinks after work, he dropped the bombshell. "I've sold everything." "What?" "Take it easy." "The new owner won't shake things up, at least not right away." Once again, Bernie proved correct. Upon meeting Gabe Zello, my initial impression was of his youthfulness. Not yet 30, he orchestrated Bernie's buyout. Taller and younger than me, Gabe possessed a striking, blonde-haired, Adonis-like appearance, embodying the epitome of a business prodigy superstar. Though I should have felt envy toward the young man, his charm and amiability made it difficult to be resentful. Working for him proved enjoyable as well. Approaching 50, Bernie was ambitious, yet fundamentally cautious. In contrast, Gabe thrived on transparency and risk-taking. He operated with everything laid bare for all to see, always pushing the boundaries. It became evident early on that his investment in a rural property had stretched his finances thin. Gabe leaned more toward financing than construction, and leaned more into management than salesmanship. He relished in quick profits, and when the real estate market rebounded, his wager on Countryman real estate clearly paid off. Meanwhile, Bernie headed to Florida, drawn to the allure of a large real estate venture. The night before his departure, I wished him luck. "Come with me, baby," he said. "No, I'm not a child anymore. I have a wife and two teenagers to support," I replied. "Okay, but someday you'll regret it." I hoped not, but I checked the job market. There's not much left of my old company. Stephen Pender, one of the junior partners, managed to weather the collapse. He was glad to hear from me, but offered only a third of my current earnings. So I worked diligently to ensure Countryman Real Estate stayed afloat. Overall, I was content working for Gabe, as we called him. He treated me well and allowed me to manage the office day to day. Did I have any doubts about him? Yes, but my only grievance with the boss was minor. Bernie never hosted a formal Christmas party, but Gabe took it to the opposite extreme. He rented one of the finest vacation spots in Saratoga, albeit during the off-season, for a hefty sum. The next party, held on the first Saturday in December, was for staff, contractors, bankers, and realtors. It was a lavish affair with a large guest list. Gabe spared no expense. Well, it was his money, and perhaps there was a legitimate business rationale behind it all. My discontent began around midnight and intensified throughout the night. You see, I arrived with the most attractive woman in the venue on my arm. I married Gloria right after college when we were both barely 22. While I was in law school, she worked a dead-end job to support us. I'll always be grateful to her for that, but she became pregnant by stopping birth control while I studied for the bar exam. In hindsight, the pregnancy may have been for the best. We've been good parents then and still are now. While I struggled with renting houses, Gloria raised our kids and worked nights to earn her doctorate in child psychology. When our youngest child started school, Gloria returned to work, landing a job at the State Department. She also embarked on what I now call her running career. Gloria could be described as chubby, especially compared to some undernourished models, but at 30, she transitioned from swimming at the YWCA pool twice a week and jogging occasionally to running long distances solo every morning. She started waking early to trek 5 miles cross-country. Each evening, she dedicated half an hour to sprinting. She held the fastest time among local female runners and was only surpassed once by national competitors in local 5K and 10K races. She even participated in the New York City Marathon 3 times, ranking among the top 100 women finishers. I'm not a stay-at-home type. I hit the gym at least 3 times a week and bike 20 miles on summer weekends. However, with over 5% body fat, I don't boast a physique sculpted by Michelangelo. I stood by Gloria in her endeavors, witnessing her early morning routines and returning sweaty as I woke the children. I felt proud of my wife, so when I entered the Christmas party with this tall, dark-haired beauty on my arm, conversations hushed and heads turned to behold the striking Gloria. Standing just over 6 feet tall in her 3-inch heels, she matched my height perfectly. Her raven locks cascaded over her shoulders, shimmering in the ballroom lamplight that evening. Despite her efforts to attend the party, Gloria wore a new form-fitting black dress. The scallop-trimmed attire hinted at her cleavage and was daringly short, showcasing her fabulously long runner's legs. This dress accentuated her flat stomach and sculpted rear, drawing admiring gazes. No longer a chubby girl, my wife exuded confidence as a remarkable woman. In Gabe's arms, she wasted no time in greeting us and joining him for a dance. Although I couldn't deny they made a lovely couple, his attentiveness seemed to border on inappropriate. Shortly before midnight, he approached her and kissed her passionately beneath the mistletoe. While I wasn't jealous, yes, my wife was attractive, but I trusted her. We had weathered many hardships together, From years of law school to raising children and paying off school loans, we had overcome illness and feticide. I felt sorry for couples who hadn't faced such trials together. It's adversity that strengthens a marriage. Gloria and I had faced everything together and remained deeply in love. As Gloria reveled in the attention while drinking, I dismissed it all as the result of the festive atmosphere. I escorted my wife home, and we didn't discuss the incident further. It was just an effect of too much hard drinks, I reassured myself. 6 months later, Memorial Day weekend rolled around, marking the halfway point of the year, which had been favorable for the real estate sector with a notable increase in clients. The final week of May experienced record-breaking heat, setting the hottest temperatures in the past decade. The company's operating account brimmed with cash from home sales, scheduled for deposit on the first business day of June. We planned to review the checks and electronically pay the banks when the office reopened after the three-day weekend. "Are you joining us for the weekend camping trip?" Gabe inquired. He had rented a mountain cabin in the Adirondacks for Memorial Day weekend and had been talking about it incessantly for weeks. Though his invitation extended to Gloria and me, I was hesitant. "I'm not sure what Gloria's plans are," I replied, attempting to decline politely. "Oh, she's coming. She's looking forward to it," Gabe insisted confidently. I regarded him with uncertainty. "We discussed it on the phone," he added hastily. Why did I doubt him? Nevertheless, after he departed, I called Gloria, and indeed, she was enthusiastic about the trip. Reflecting on it now, I realized that this was the pivotal moment to avert disaster, but I failed to recognize it. I loved Gloria deeply and trusted her implicitly. According to MapQuest, the journey to Gabe's house would be challenging. I traded my Honda Accord for a four-wheel drive SUV at the rental place. The last 20 miles of the route were along mountain roads, with the final 3 miles on dirt tracks. Having visited the Adirondack Mountains before, I knew firsthand their rugged nature. Gabe's residence lay southwest of Saranac Lake, and the journey took nearly 4 hours. The GPS guided us for the last 5 miles, leading us off the beltway onto the final 2 miles of semi-paved road that terminated at a sturdy wooden bridge. Though narrow, the recently renovated bridge spanned a ravine. While not excessively wide, the gap was deep, characteristic of the terrain typical of the Adirondack Mountains. It's such challenging terrain that preserves their untamed wilderness. I traversed the bridge cautiously, contemplating if there might be another route available. Despite the absence of an alternate exit on the GPS map, I felt like a mouse ensnared in a trap, wondering if there might be a lurking carnivore nearby. 3 miles along a rugged dirt road, we arrived at a two-story house nestled on a clearing on the mountainside, roughly 1,000 feet below the summit. A dozen Adirondack peaks loomed to the north, providing a picturesque backdrop to this remote location where what appeared to be a rustic cabin had been erected. I parked the SUV in a meticulously maintained parking lot adjacent to three similarly upscale vehicles. Everything appeared pristine and meticulously tended to. The cabin itself exemplified the modern log building aesthetic that evoked rustic charm while boasting contemporary comforts. Adorned in a fusion of modern and traditional paneling, it exuded the ambiance of a 19th-century mountain retreat, albeit with modern conveniences. It was evident that Gabe had spared no expense to create this illusion. I had little doubt about his intended audience for such ostentation, and it certainly wasn't me. We were welcomed on the expansive porch adorned with Adirondack chairs and rustic decor by a group of 6 individuals. Among them were 3 young men, Gabe, and 2 of his college acquaintances. Ken Lewis, the shortest among them at about 5'10", possessed a muscular physique akin to a weightlifter, nearing his 30s. Though starting to bald like Gabe, Ken's rugged features were accentuated by his muscular frame visible beneath his tight t-shirt and shorts. The second college friend, Glenn Sachs, stood at roughly 6 feet tall, slender with curly blonde hair. He appeared more aesthetically pleasing than Ken, his arms wrapped around a blonde woman introduced as Sharon. Sharon exuded beauty with her voluptuous figure and ample bust, likely in her 30s, possibly older, and noticeably 8 to 10 years Glenn's senior. Standing beside Ken was Robin, a slightly younger woman clearly accompanying him. She possessed a bubbly demeanor, short stature, and a well-endowed physique, with bosom seemingly disproportionate to her petite frame. The final member of the group stood tall with flowing brown hair. She was Paula Henry, one of those individuals often described as beautiful, possessing attractive, yet sharply defined, not entirely feminine features. Her demeanor suggested intelligence. a trait acknowledged by herself and others. Clearly the youngest among the women, she was a schoolmate of the boys. Despite the warm and overly enthusiastic welcome we received, there was an air of peculiarity. Gabe specifically greeted my wife with enthusiasm, while I received a more perfunctory acknowledgement. Meanwhile, his friend Paula regarded me with a scrutinizing gaze, akin to one observing a laboratory specimen before dissection. Dinner arrangements were swiftly made, prompting us to hastily stow our belongings in our designated second-floor bedroom adjacent to Gabe's master suite. Seated in the expansive great hall, serving as a combined living room, dining area, and game room, we indulged in gourmet microwave meals around the grand oak table. Though the food was delectable, it was evident that it came with considerable expense and minimal effort. Wine flowed generously, and I monitored my intake, mindful of my host's persistent attempts to replenish our glasses. Post-dinner, the group congregated around the gas fireplace on the terrace, where potent drinks and herb made an appearance, setting the tone for a weekend characterized by revelry and mild use. As I navigated through the situation with careful inquiry and astute observation, what initially seemed like a typical holiday weekend with my boss, his friends, and their partners took on a more intricate undertone. It soon became apparent that Robin had a fiancé elsewhere, while Sharon was married with two children and a husband waiting at home. Infidelity was treated with casual disregard and even humor. Paula remained fixated on me, seemingly detached from the group. Although she appeared to be aligned with Gabe, she showed no offense at his overt flirtation with my wife. Throughout the night, Gabe positioned himself mostly between Gloria and Paula, directing most of his conversation towards Gloria. My attempts to engage Paula were met with polite but distant interest, signaling me to refrain from further interaction. As midnight approached, the guests, still in high spirits, seemed prepared to retire for the night. Yet an unspoken anticipation lingered. Suddenly, Gabe addressed me, acknowledging my probable fatigue from the lengthy drive. "Are you ready for bed, Lyle?" Gloria suggested, to which I jokingly insisted on another drink, offering it to Gabe. Internally, I fumed at Gabe's attempts to seduce my wife, questioning Gloria's behavior throughout the evening. Was she truly enamored with him? It was a night of waiting, but ultimately I emerged victorious. Returning to our designated room, Gloria entered the shower alone, and I refrained from joining her, recognizing the futility. Upon her exit, she sat undressed on the edge of the bed, inviting me to join her. "I want to enjoy this weekend," she expressed, reflecting on our challenging past and acknowledging my unwavering support. "You've been an exceptional partner and parent, sacrificing for my education and nurturing our family. Your dedication has not gone unnoticed. I'm proud to be your wife." I woke to the morning sunlight flooding through the open blinds of the spacious bedroom window. Typically, Gloria rose much earlier than I did for my morning jog, but last night's indulgence in hard drinks and bang had its effects. Rising from bed, I drew the curtains shut and made my way to the compact bathroom with a shower. Despite its size, the bathroom boasted ample amenities. After showering and shaving, I headed downstairs before the others had stirred, opting to explore the surroundings while the house was still quiet. Moving from the main room to a patio featuring a fire pit and built-in outdoor BBQ, I then ventured onto a raised terrace housing a small pool and sauna. Considering the chilly spring climate of these mountains, an open water feature seemed risky, but as I stepped onto the terrace, I discovered the entire area was heated. Solar panels adorned the higher slopes of the mountain, heating both the pool and likely the house. Crossing the terrace, I reached what appeared to be a small barn, devoid of animals but stocked with ATVs, snowmobiles, and gardening tools, including several small tractors. As I passed by, the distant sound of a babbling stream caught my attention. About 20 yards behind a locked barn with a chimney protruding from its roof, I glimpsed through a small window, spotting a generator and fuel tanks. It was evident that meticulous care was taken to ensure the provision of gasoline for recreational vehicles and emergency power through the generator. This location felt like its own secluded universe, evidently prepared for any conceivable scenario. Despite the stream appearing small and shallow, I reconsidered its size when witnessing a fish leap from its waters. "Are you fishing?" came a voice from behind me. Turning, I found Paula standing there.
"Not today, but I used to when I had more free time.
Seems like this weekend might offer you that chance."
"Are you into fishing?" I inquired.
"No, like you, I lack the time."
"Perhaps we could have breakfast and then take a hike up the mountain.
It'd be a shame to come all this way and not reach the summit," she suggested. Paula prepared coffee in the stainless steel maker while the kitchen pantry held microwave-ready breakfast options. Opting for instant oatmeal, I noticed none of the others had yet stirred. They'd likely sleep in.
"How about that hike?" she proposed, smiling.
With Paula evidently knowing the trail's beginning, she led us straight to it. Initially, the summit didn't seem too far, but an hour later, it felt as distant as when we began. "Are you sure about reaching the top?" I questioned.
"Why quit now, old man?" she teased. "I'm just thinking about what the others will say when they find us missing."
"Don't worry, I doubt they'll mind." Finally reaching the summit, the sun positioned nearly overhead indicated noon was nearing. The mountain's peak was somewhat underwhelming, with a flat area bordered by rounded edges. Two weathered wooden benches faced east, offering views of the gatehouse and several distant peaks to the south and east. Though the fog obscured distant vistas, the air felt crisp and pure. Seating herself, Paula appeared content to soak in the view.
"Mind if I join you?" she asked.
"I'd like to rest before heading back down."
"No, the old man could use a rest," I responded, prompting a smile from me.
"So, Glenn is a broker, Ken is a banker, and Gabe is a developer."
"But despite talking all night, I never found out what you do," I remarked, eyeing her thoughtfully.
She seemed to weigh the question, assessing the potential consequences.
"I'm an inspector. I work for the government. It's a low-paying and rather dull job," she divulged.
"Have you inspected anyone we know?" I inquired.
"Not recently. Back in college, it felt like I was always bailing them out, covering for them with angry girlfriends or providing cheat sheets for exams. They were always on the edge. That's what makes them who they are. You know, extraordinary young people," she explained.
"So, is this your job now?
Covering for them?
What's the point of closing the barn door after the horse has bolted? It won't help you retrieve your horse. Rules just hold things back. It's better if smart people rise to the top and the rest step aside. Ultimately, everyone benefits according to their own merits," I mused.
"What about your role this weekend? You didn't attend the party last night," I pointed out.
She fell silent, caught off guard by the question. I rose and moved to where I could see the road leading down the mountain. There was only one way out. The way out. Turning back to Paula, I scrutinized her. Had she considered this? The others, I realized in a moment of insight, were entirely oblivious to anything beyond their own physical desires.
But was she?
Clearly, she was observant. She must see the issue as I did.
"I'm just here as the designated sober one. I ensure everything runs smoothly, intervening only if absolutely necessary," she explained.
"Meaning, unless the Golden Boys need you," I summarized.
"I wouldn't put it like that, but I certainly prioritize what's best for them, for everyone, in the long run," she clarified.
"Shall we head downstairs?" I suggested.
"What's the rush? The journey back will be quicker," she remarked.
"Yes, quicker, but the slope is steep and perhaps more perilous. You could take a nasty fall," I cautioned.
"Why worry when you're already at the top?"
she retorted, though she rose and began to descend.
We returned to the lodge without incident, yet my concerns intensified. Finding the others by the pool, I was taken aback by my wife's appearance in a black bikini, revealing her body in a manner I hadn't seen before. The other women were similarly clad. As Paula and I approached, I witnessed my wife seated on Gabe's lap, engaged in a passionate kiss.
"We're back!"
Paula's shout interrupted Gabe and Gloria's kiss. Gabe grinned mischievously while Gloria's smile seemed forced.
"Where have you two been?"
Gloria asked casually, breaking the awkward silence. My fists clenched instinctively, but Paula squeezed my hand.
"Well, since we missed lunch and conquered the mountain, we deserve some food," Paula declared, pulling me towards the cabin.
As we left the pool area, I heard muted laughter. I wasn't sure what Paula had prepared, and if I ate anything, I couldn't recall. She handed me a glass of straight black Johnny Walker, which burned as it went down.
"Think before you act," she advised. "It's just one weekend in a good marriage, and you need to consider your family."
Returning to the pool, the couples were already settled in the jacuzzi, laughing and giggling. My wife remained seated on Gabe's lap. I couldn't see their hands underwater, but I assumed they were occupied. A joint was passed around, and it was evident that everyone was intoxicated. Paula positioned herself where she could keep an eye on things, placing herself between the jacuzzi and me. I pretended to drink more before discreetly walking away. Out of sight, I poured out the contents of my glass. It was a strange mix of jealousy and pride. I was proud of my wife's transformation from the chubby girl I married to the beautiful, athletic woman she had become, rightfully desired by others. I took pride in the fact that men longed to be in her loving, strong arms. But what about her inner self as she sculpted her physique? Seeing her with Gabe had an oddly alluring quality. I could picture their flawless bodies entwined physically, a nightmarish yet exhilarating image. I strolled around the lodge grounds, observing its operations, passing time while dreading the direction things seemed to be heading, realizing that ultimately, I might need to take control of my options. Entering our bedroom, I made a deliberate attempt to sleep. As I lay there, trying to quiet my mind, the question of why my wife was flirting and kissing another man lingered. We had weathered many hardships together, from our early struggles with poverty to our children's illnesses and the constant financial strain of living on a middle-class income. We were finally starting to climb towards stability. Our children had reached an age of independence, my wife had a modest but steady career, and I was earning a good income after years of financial struggle. Our debts were manageable and our future looked promising. So why risk it all for someone as shallow and empty as Gabe Zillow? Behind his charm and boldness, there was nothing substantial. Strip away the flashy exterior and there was emptiness. Gabe had never designed a site plan, built or sold a home. He was the figurehead of a business run by others, a wealthy individual with no real substance, a prodigy whose only asset was his image. What was Gloria thinking? She claimed she just wanted to have fun this weekend. Was this her idea of fun, and how would it end? I must have fallen asleep because when I descended the stairs, they had already gathered in the main room. Lunch had passed, but the drinks were still flowing, and joints were being passed around. Gloria was back in Gabe's lap, and there was no denying they had kissed. The women had removed their bikini tops, including Paula, who seemed to be sharing Ken with Robin. I headed straight for the kitchen to heat up dinner in the microwave when Gloria walked in. "How are you?" she asked. "It could have been better," I replied. There was a moment of hesitation before she spoke again. "I spent the evening with Gabe," she confessed. "I noticed," I said as the microwave beeped. She gave a strange smile when I turned to attend to the microwave. "No, I mean tonight, in his room." I remained very still, facing away from her, not wanting her to see the pain she was causing. "I see. But what about our 16 years of marriage?" I questioned. "That's why I can do this. It's only for the weekend. Next week I'll be all yours again," she assured. "And Gabe won't mind?" I retorted. She hugged me from behind, burying her head against my back. "Gabe likes you. He thinks you two are going somewhere. It's just a fling. A little fun for the weekend, okay?" she asked, her words punctuated by hugs. "Can I choose?" I inquired. "Not really. It's decided. I'm just letting you know," she replied. She released me, and I heard her leave the kitchen. I walked to where the kitchen opened into the main room. They were already heading up the stairs. Gabe glanced back, smiling and giving me a thumbs up as if we were on the same page. He whispered something to Gloria, who turned around, waved, and smiled at me. I returned to the kitchen, feeling as though everything we had been through together meant nothing. My wife had left me and humiliated me. I discarded the food from the microwave and made coffee instead. It was going to be a long night. As the water started to boil, I heard footsteps entering the kitchen. I turned to find Paula observing me. "I didn't expect there to be caffeine. Wouldn't something else be better?" she queried. "Everyone has their preferences," I replied. "But tell me, what's your role here?" She shrugged in response. "I'm just trying to ensure things remain calm." "And how do you plan to do that? By sleeping with me?" she chuckled. "No, I wouldn't go that far. But don't lose hope. You'll have your wife back, and maybe even a bonus." "So, there's money involved," I noted. "Isn't it always the case? You can't make waves when you work for this man. You have to consider your family. What choice do you have but to accept what's offered? This is their world, not yours. That's just how it goes." A sharp moan of pleasure echoed from above. "Seems like she's having a good time," Paula grinned. "Well, good for her. A delightful weekend for everyone in the mountains. You know, these rocks have stood here for ages. Our existence is merely a fleeting moment for them. Thousands of years ago, they were buried under layers of ice that carved through them, forming the rivers and gorges we now navigate to make our world livable. Sometimes we forget how fragile our existence is. Remove one small piece and our world crumbles. Only then do we realize it's all an illusion." Paula laughed. "Wow, you're quite the philosopher." "No, just someone who understands what truly matters, striving to discern the genuine from the fleeting illusions." She probably assumed I wouldn't stir up any trouble, leaving me alone with my coffee and my anguish. Around 1 o'clock in the morning, I ascended the stairs. Passing the master bedroom door, I was greeted by loud screams and pleasure-filled moans from my wife. She had always been quiet during our carnal moments, but it seemed he brought her more satisfaction. Younger and more vigorous, he excelled in every aspect. It appeared my wife had found the pleasure she sought in his embrace. I showered and changed into warm attire, anticipating the cold outside. I tried to drown out the noises echoing through the walls as I waited. By the time silence finally descended upon the house, it was well past 3 o'clock in the morning. Waiting another 30 minutes, I ventured downstairs. In a kitchen cabinet, I discovered a flashlight and candles with matches, a prudent measure, I reasoned, in case reality severed our connection to electricity. The night enveloped the surroundings in a profound darkness, with the moon having already set. The nocturnal symphony of the mountains, though, felt like silence to someone accustomed to city life. I easily located a barn and a 20-gallon plastic canister filled with motorsports gas. A wrench lay nearby. Though a padlock secured the generator shed door, the hinge mechanism had succumbed to rust. The wrench swiftly liberated it. The house's owners had thoughtfully provided a manual gasoline pump, enabling me to swiftly fill the canister. In less than 10 minutes, I navigated around the lodge to reach my rented SUV's parking spot. I loaded a gas can into the back, released the handbrake, and shifted the transmission into drive. Allowing the car to roll downhill, I started it up and drove off cautiously as I neared the bridge. Carefully navigating it, I halted upon reaching the gravel road. Taking my time, I ensured the gasoline seeped into the bridge's wood. It was a meticulously crafted structure, a testament to skilled artisans who took pride in their work. Regular folks had built this bridge to facilitate the leisure of those who profited off the toil of others. But the fun was about to come to an abrupt end. Dropping the match, it sputtered before igniting. Flames swiftly erupted, and I quickly retreated as a fierce explosion of heat and fire ensued. The wooden bridge crackled and collapsed into the inferno, its blaze likely visible for miles around. Turning back to my car, I drove away leisurely. There was no need to hurry. Anyone who witnessed the fire was now stranded on the other side. I was confident I'd be long gone before they realized their predicament. By the time dawn broke, I was already stopping at a gas station off the highway. Filling up the SUV, I left the empty canister at the pumps, certain someone would eventually collect it. Any link between the fire and me would vanish. Returning the SUV around 9 a.m., I retrieved my car. After showering and dressing casually for the office, I had two final tasks to sever ties with Countryman Real Estate. Bernie, though a good boss, was forgetful, often leaving items in his office. With keys to every door and filing cabinet, I had easy access. Gabe, meticulous with his belongings, kept the combination to his desk safe, in a folder labeled Security, stored in a locked closet. Thanks to Bernie's keys, I gained entry and retrieved the password diary from the safe, accessing the company's personal account. It would have been simple to abscond with everything, but that wasn't my intent. Theft would only lead to trouble. Instead, I transferred the operating account to another. Initially, when I joined Countryman, we established a trust account for deposits, as per state regulations. Over time, new trust accounts were created for each project, while the original was forgotten. Although the previous account was archived, it wasn't recorded in the ledgers. It remained empty until I injected nearly $20 million into it. Safeguarding all our cash, I bolstered our line of credit as a precaution, ensuring my actions didn't seem hollow. Nothing was stolen, everything remained intact. However, it would take days to locate and return the funds. In the wee hours of Tuesday morning, electronic transfers will hit an empty account, halting hundreds of payments. Unsure of the extent of damage, our reliance on credit left us vulnerable. Remove that lifeline, and we'll face tough times, at least temporarily. It'll be an uphill battle for Countrymen to rebuild their creditworthiness. The longer the shortfall persists, the more dire the situation becomes. With luck, Gabe will still be away in the mountains. On Tuesday, once all is set, I'll print my resignation letter before departing the office. As I was about to leave, placing the letter on Gabe's secretary's desk, my cell buzzed. Glancing at the screen, I saw Gloria's photo, but I let it go to voicemail, though I couldn't resist listening.
"Where are you, baby? The car's missing and I'm worried sick. Call me,"
her voice pleaded. About 30 minutes later, Gabe called.
"Hey, Lyle, you okay? Gloria's frantic. Call her,"
he urged, with a hint of threat at the end. Oddly, it amused me. On Sunday, Gloria called 3 times, with 2 more calls from Gabe, the latter sounding more forceful, insisting I get in touch. Monday morning, I fetched the kids from Gloria's parents. As I left, Gloria called again,
Be home tonight, we need to talk. If you get this call,
I'm really worried, she implored. This is childish, she added. I doubted she'd return. At her parents', they were expecting me. Gloria called again, saying,
You might be on your own picking up the kids.
Her mother urged me to call, while her father suggested waiting until she returned. There are things we need to sort out, he remarked. Personally, I aimed to steer clear of familial debates. They weren't pleased, but there wasn't much they could do. My daughter sensed tension, but I assured her, This is between Mom and me. We'll discuss it when she returns, out of fairness to her. After settling the kids in, I retreated to our old bedroom and dialed Felix Rodriguez. How's it going, Lyle? He greeted. Not great. Felix, I need your expertise, I confided. Felix, a top-notch family lawyer and stand-up guy, listened attentively. What's going on? He inquired. I need to file for divorce, I stated firmly. We delved into details over an hour, scheduling an appointment for late Tuesday to kickstart the process. Meanwhile, calls persisted from the mountains. It seems her parents got in touch with her. The tone of the messages changed. Gloria and Gabe reached out without threats. Hey, if I messed up, I apologize. Let's not let this weekend affect our professional relationship. It wouldn't be good for anyone if you catch my drift, Gabe stated. Later, around 5 p.m., Gloria reached out urgently. Lyle, please call. Something's happened here. There's no bridge. We're all stuck. Call me. I need to talk, she urged. Bright and early Tuesday, I rang up Stephen Pender, my old buddy. We arranged to meet for lunch at a nearby diner. Are you sure about this? Stephen mused between bites. Done deal. I've officially resigned, I affirmed. As if to emphasize, Donna, my former secretary at Countryman, called. Lyle, they're saying you've resigned, but you've got to come in. Everything's going haywire. Something's seriously off, Donna relayed. Sorry, I can't. I'm no longer with the company. You should ring up Gabe. They say he's stranded in the mountains. Something about a bridge, huh? Tough break. Don't worry, though. It'll all work out. Anything else I should know? Steve inquired. Nope, not my concern anymore, I replied. Well, if you're sure, I think I can up my last offer by $10,000 a year. Can you start tomorrow? Isn't that too soon? Nope, perfect, Steve confirmed. Wednesday morning, I joined Pandare and Partners. Just settling in that afternoon, I had an unexpected visitor. Where's my money? You're an idiot, Gabe Zello stormed in. What money are you talking about? You know, operating funds? Sorry, you might want to chat with the company accountants. If I do that, I'll sue you for embezzlement, he threatened. I just smirked. He found his way down that mountain. But where are the operational funds? You think you're some hotshot lawyer, but you're just an idiot who can't satisfy his wife. She really enjoyed her time with me, and I'll keep her happy whenever I feel like it, he spat, then stormed off. The next day, the police called me to the station for questioning. Sorry, I've just started a new job. My time's tight, but I can respond to your questions in writing and call you back, I offered. The officer tried to explain they don't usually do that, but I insisted, citing my profession. After some back and forth, he hung up. I anticipated the police would need to investigate the embezzlement claim, tracing the money. They'd find it in the company account where I deposited it days ago. I figured that'd be the end of it, a civil matter at most, and an unsuccessful one. I was mistaken. It took them a fortnight to track down the missing funds. By then, Countryman was in dire straits. Its credit had been completely cut off by the banks, necessitating an infusion of new capital to reopen it. Gloria arrived late Friday evening with both our trip suitcases. Her key no longer worked due to my changing the locks. I met her at the door.
Please, Lyle, let me in. Think about the children if not for me, she pleaded.
No, you don't live here anymore. I parked your car on the street. I assume you still have the keys, I replied. Do you hate me that much? Yes, I affirmed, closing the door. I decided she would go to her parents. I instructed Felix to serve her with a restraining order and file for divorce. The brief reprieve the bridge provided paid off handsomely. With Felix's help, she was kept away, and I gained temporary custody of the children. It took her 2 months and likely every penny she had to get back on her feet. By then, the divorce proceedings were well underway, needing only finalization. Gabe Zillow wasn't as fortunate. Countryman Real Estate had to shut down, ceasing operations right after Labor Day. The following week, I had an unexpected visitor. He sat in the visitor's chair upon my return from closing the third deal. With a deep tan and looking healthy, he was lightly dressed for the northern autumn. Bernie, how's it going? I greeted. I'm doing all right, he replied, scanning my modest office. What brings you to the cold north?
I inquired, sensing this was no casual visit.
Well, here's the thing. Florida's swarming with sharks, and most of them aren't in the water. I figured I'd stick to what I know, he explained.
I'm glad to see you back, I said, uncertain of his intentions.
Bernie read my expression.
I took a hit down there, starting over, but it seems I got lucky.
This company I own seems affordable, he revealed, a smile appearing.
We exchanged knowing smiles.
So what's on your mind, old pirate? I asked.
Well, here's the deal. I need a partner. At my age, bankers doubt any venture I start will last, and, well, you and I make a good team.
What do you say? He proposed.
I have very little money. You've probably heard about my impending divorce, I mentioned.
Yes, I have, he acknowledged, hinting at the spreading gossip.
Let's go with 10%, he offered.
50? Let's be reasonable. You said you're strapped for cash, but I'll settle for 45%, I countered.
Look, 25% is fair, but it's not enough. How about 40% and an option to buy another 10% in 10 years, he negotiated.
All right, let's hope I live to see it, I quipped, knowing he'd likely outlast me.
Bernie and I were back in business. We acquired every lot owned by Countrymen at a discount using the same bank's funds. I anticipated challenges, but our business quickly thrived, constructing and selling homes. Life progressed as usual, as did my divorce proceedings. It largely centered on custody and visitation. Ultimately, we devised a complex joint custody and visitation arrangement. That's why I returned to a dark, empty house on Christmas Eve. Gloria had taken the children for Christmas, though I was supposed to have them. Given that Christmas fell on a Sunday, they had to return to her on Monday, her day off. The kids struggled with this routine. Approaching the house, I spotted a figure on the steps, sheltered from the cold and the light snowfall. I was beside her before recognizing my ex-wife.
Gloria, what are you doing here? I inquired.
She didn't seem well. Thinner than before, her eyes appeared vacant and indifferent. It was evident she had recently cried.
I want to go home, she whimpered.
Where are the children? I asked, sidestepping her request.
With my parents. They want to come home too. We want to be a family again in our little house. What you did to us is unfair.
I didn't do anything like that.
Well, yes, that's true. I made a mistake, okay? It was a bad and hurtful mistake, but it was just one mistake.
You're the one who tore our family apart, she accused,
her voice tinged with anger. Making a conscious effort to regain composure, she said, I promised myself I wouldn't lose my temper, but you need to understand, I struggle with anger because of this.
You have anger issues?
I was surprised.
Don't act innocent, that's not who you are. Were you just ahead of the game?
I'm not naive, Lyle. You were never a saint. I know I hurt you, but it was never intentional. Do you honestly expect me to believe that sleeping with another man right in front of me wouldn't hurt? I replied. She turned away, clearly wounded by my words. I watched as she wiped her eyes, her back now facing me. It was evident she was crying. I was always the overweight one, the last choice on the dance floor. I had to settle for whoever showed interest. I was a good girl, enduring countless insults. I waited all through high school and most of college for the right person. When I met you, I thought I had found him. I was a maid when we got married. I didn't make a fuss about it, but I assumed you knew. You weren't a prince then, and you certainly aren't now. You were just an ordinary guy, but I loved you with all my heart.
Yes, you were a bit sharper and more ambitious than the rest. But we were always struggling financially. I learned to adjust my expectations because of my love for you. It pained me to witness your constant struggles.
Then Gabriel entered the picture, and suddenly everything seemed to improve. He possessed all the qualities a woman desires in a man. This time the prince had his eyes on me. It was incredibly flattering. After the Christmas party, he kept reaching out to me. It wasn't serious, just harmless flirting. You know, attractive women often receive attention like that. I've been approached before, but never by someone from the beautiful and powerful elite. He spoke highly of you and expressed how fortunate I am to have such an amazing boyfriend like you. I bet he was just enamored with me, I remarked.
Exactly. He mentioned how hard you work and how he wants to reward you.
I understood his implications. If I played nice with him, he would take care of you. I suppose I let him convince me that you would benefit if I gave in to him. And it's true. There was a part of me that desired him. It felt like there was this irrational urge guiding me toward him. I was torn between hoping something would happen over the weekend and fearing it. But once we arrived, my resistance began to fade. I turned to you and confessed.
What? Are you serious? You told me you were considering sleeping with him.
Okay. I didn't say it outright. But you knew what was going on and you didn't object.
she said, turning to me. Tears streamed down her cheeks, dripping from her chin, and her nose was running. I trusted you. We've spent 16 years together. How could you betray me like this? I lamented. But that's the crux of it. We loved each other. It was merely a fleeting affair. It pales in comparison to what we shared before and what lies ahead. Are you so deluded to think that, after hearing your cries of pleasure for him, we can salvage anything meaningful? Oh, for heaven's sake, you can't be that naive. It was all a facade. I aimed to please him. I put on quite a performance. Individuals like him demand and anticipate such theatrics. That's not how I behave in bed. And after 16 years of closeness with me, you should know that. All I know is what you did, how you degraded me. You chose the golden boy over me, the cad who offers nothing and takes everything. Powerful, isn't it? So, where is he now? What happened when the crisis hit? I'll tell you everything. He folded under pressure. We live in a society that perpetuates the dominance of the few over the many, based on the myth of some hidden brilliance they possess. Explain to me, how did this genius manage to descend the mountain so swiftly? He called for a helicopter. By then, he suspected that you had tampered with the business. It was glaringly obvious that you had sabotaged the bridge. He thought you embezzled his funds. The others began to panic. Paula insisted that this couldn't be true, that it couldn't happen like that. When the helicopter arrived, there was only space for Gabe. The rest resigned. I believe the National Guard eventually erected a temporary bridge to rescue us. Sharon and I reconciled. By then, her husband had already discovered the truth. She faced consequences just like me. Poor Robin's fiancé called off the engagement. Glenn and Ken encountered trouble, but I think they managed to resolve it with Paula's assistance. It seems it was only Gabe and us, regular folks, who truly bore the brunt of it all.
But wasn't the pain sufficient?
She asked, peering at me with hope. Gloria's words held a lot of truth. I wasn't entirely blameless. I toiled for Gabe, yet unlike the rest of the world, I never aligned myself with him. I knew the truth, but refused to acknowledge it to myself. I can't overlook how it transpired. They were nothing but empty promises. If scrutinized closely, one could discern a trap. But no one looked. Illusion proved more enticing than reality. We weathered through tough times, and they passed with time. What you and Gabe stripped from me was the sanctuary of my home. I'll never regain it, because those scoundrels demonstrated that what I believed in was a mirage. You and I were an illusion. With that said, I rose and made for the door of the dim, vacant house. She persisted.
Answer me this, she implored. Would you prefer solitude without me, or would you rather be with me and our children around the Christmas tree tonight?
I gazed at her. It would be effortless to embrace her, cherish her, bring the children back to sleep in their own beds on Christmas Eve, and pretend that what occurred never did. But all I could muster was, that's a valid question. But I lack an answer. With those words, we turned away from each other. The past cannot be altered. We must forge ahead for our future.